Pleasure to introduce you, Dimitri. So thank you for all coming, and we're very honored to have Dimitri Zaitsev. Is that close enough?
Yes, close.
Okay. And Dimitri is a, what's the organization again? I'm
blanking International out. Humanitarian University.
No, no, I know your university, but you're here
and
on a fellowship.
It's in Ukraine, and here it is Innovative Computing Laboratory for Tennessee University of Knoxville.
You're a Fulbright scholar.
Yes,
that's
I'm
what I was trying to tell you.
A Fulbright scholar here. Yeah. Thank you very much for this foundation.
Yeah, yeah. We're very fortunate. We don't get too many Fulbright scholars here, so we're honored to have you. And we're all going to find out today what SLEPSOV Net Computing is. I think it's based on PetriNets, but you'll tell us more.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you for being here.
I will get in complexity by and by. At first, I'd like to thank my country, Ukraine, and my clothes. Today, I am the colors of Ukraine flag. So, yellow and blue. So, I invite you to our country. Please visit it, especially city, Odessa, where International Humanitarian University is situated. Many remarkable places, including one of the best opera in Europe.
One of the best opera theater
in Europe. You can come and listen opera. Our guests enjoy very much with sea, because Black Sea is not so salty like Mediterranean. Your eyes are not aching when you're diving. So, welcome to Ukraine, welcome to Odessa. My second thanks to Fulbright Foundation because of this brilliant opportunity of visiting United States of America. And my thanks to my host. My host is a legend of exascale computing. Thank you very much to Jed Dangara for his kind invitation and brilliant opportunity to spend 3 months working in his best in the world exascale computing laboratory. Thank you very much for Stony Brook University and Scott personally for this invitation and brilliant opportunities for lecturing here. And I'd like to bring your best wishes from Anatoly Ilyich Slepsov, who lives and works in Kyiv in Pedagogical University. He is an outstanding scientist. And now I come directly to the central question. Central question, write programs or draw programs? When I try to discuss this question with different people's opinions were different. Some of them say when you write very big program, it is rather difficult to draw it. You should write it in some textual language. Others say when you write a concurrent program, it is very easy to be tangled when you write in textual language, when you use some graphics. It is more clean how it will be executed. So opinions are divided, and let us pay some attention to facilities for concurrent programming. And these facilities, like preliminary to PetriNets, come from United States of America, because this family team of Gilbreth has invented special language to specify production processes. And they invented it in 1921. And in my opinion, afterwards it was standardized. And when Holstein and John von Neumann were offering their suggestions for flow charts, they were using this language. But language of flow charts had thrown facilities for concurrent computations aside because people on the at the early stage of computing were absorbed mostly in sequential programming. So it is like a regional scheme of production process from Gilbreth paper. And here we have like parallel branches and different kinds of blocks, which remind us of concurrent processes in Petri nets. So from some point of view, I consider Petri nets as maybe restricted and unified schemes which were proposed by Gilbreth many years ago, and I think some 40 years before the paper of Carl Petrie. Then, when you come to program schemata in the Novosibirsk school of scientists who were studying parallel processes, it also reminds us about places and transition. For instance, in Yanov schemata, in Lavrov schemata, and so on. So people were using this kind of graphical specification years before. It was offered maybe in some unified form of place transition nets. And as for Ukrainian technologies of programming, we should mention our technology of programming offered by Glushkov and Vilbitsky, which was successful for years. People were drawing programs in R schemes on the screen of alphabetical numbering computers, not on graphical displays, and it worked good enough. And it was proven that even the number of characters required is less than for usual program, and the logic of program was more clear when you were using this kind of scheme. It's my personal preference. I prefer, when I write down some schemata for a program, I use R schemes, because thank you very much to Vladimir Andreevich Ryutsky, who taught me how to write programs. He was using these R schemes, and I got accustomed to using it. And when we analyze graphical languages of recent time, we should mention Dracon project from Russia, which was applied for real-life software development for Buran space shuttle. It is a very interesting program, space program. And Microsoft Visual Programming Language and other languages for Android and other systems, which are employed today in usual program software development process. It is an example how you can create program in Dracon system. From my point of view, everything is perfect here with standard flowchart blocks, but when it comes to concurrent processes, they have no formal facility. They added some blocks, but from my point of view, it is difficult to prove correctness of parallel programs using these blocks. But it is an example of a programming language where people draw programs, write a bit inside blocks, but mainly draw programs. UML is a kind of a system where you draw programs, but from my point of view, too many diagrams, some of them use even PetriNet notation for specifying concurrent processes. It is very big system. Maybe from my point of view, it likes a uniform approach. It is too rich maybe to have formal methods for analysis of programs for proving correctness. Maybe it is personal opinion which could be discussed. And when we come to notation of Petri nets, we have a few examples of graphical systems, for instance, this one HPS, which uses transitions and places, and some inscriptions on arcs, transitions and places, some additional textual language. What we offer in our speech,
what about data flow language?
Yes, data flow. Yeah, I should maybe insert one slide. Thank you, Scott. But I was throwing away one third of my slides when I was thinking about limitations of time. Yes, the data flow language is like a posit approach to control flow. You can use it for parallel programs, and maybe I should mention it as well. But from this point of view of graphical and textual programming, I'd like to mention that we'd like to have pure graphical programming. Many approaches offer us some graph, which is weighted with textual language. We offer programming using graphs only, nothing save graphs. So for these purposes, special kind of place transition nets, which were offered by outstanding Ukrainian scientist Anatoly Ilyich Slepcov, were applied. Petri nets were known for years, but from the computational point of view, they are very slow when it comes to computing arithmetic operations. In Slepcov nets, you can fire the same transition in multiple instances. Because of this, you have very fast language for concurrent programming, which runs exponentially faster than PetriNet. And it, in my opinion, and opinion of many other scientists, justifies using special term for Slepcov nets because they are fast. And here we have massively parallel computations if we implement a new kind of hardware for Slepcov nets. I call it computing memory. If we implement it in hardware, we have massively parallel computations, very fine granulation of these concurrent computations, and we have possibilities of using concurrent language, which preserves natural parallelism of application area. So we have many advantages when we implement this approach. And now I'd like to pay a certain attention to difference between PetriNets. And I'd like to mention also this name Salvitsky, Andrzej Salvitsky from Poland. In PetriNets, we fire only one single transition at a step. Salvitsky offered the maximal firing strategy when you can fire maximal set of transitions in parallel at a step. And Slepcov offered multiple firing strategy. When you have multiple firing conditions, you can fire the same transition in a few instances at a step. So, from my point of view, we should keep three names because it's different nets. They define different nets with different properties. And the most general are Slepcov nets, and other nets are special cases of it. Here I compare transition firing rules. In Slepcov nets, we fire transition T1 in two instances and obtain this next marking, while in PetriNet, you are obliged to do it using two steps. So it is like central slide to understand what the difference. We have the same rules. You should have to have marking of all input places for a transition, but here we have like multiplicity of firing conditions equal to 2 and 2 instances of the same transition fire at a step. It is a crucial point which allows you to have efficient computations on this kind of place transition nets.
Sorry, what if you are interested in the intermediate step?
Yeah, if you are interested in the intermediate step, you can have special facilities to stop your net in intermediate step. So when you attach, for instance, to this transition a place which has marking equal to unit, you restrict the multiplicity to unit. Okay. And you can have intermediate steps. If you'd like maybe to trace your program, to debug your program, it could be useful. But when you have multiple firing, it makes computations very fast on such kind of net. And the next slide contains a comparison of reachability graph for this simple net having two transition. It is reachability graph for Petrip firing rule, and it is reachability graph for Slipsov firing rule. So sometimes you can have like brief notation for this, maybe something which is considered like intermediate steps or hidden steps from point of view of tracing this system.
Previous one. Yeah.
So at each step, if you have transition fireable, transition is fireable if you have at least one token in each input place. So it is fireable. When it fires, it extracts one token from each input place and put one token to each output.
So the P3 was 1 initially or something?
But only one transition. If you have here, we have only one transition net, but if you have more transitions, only one fires at a step. So it
is. I was asking about P3. That's the notation for one token, the single token.
One token,
yeah.
A count of one is
just one. Here it is 2 and one less in these input places. And two are gone, and the same final marking, only we miss this intermediate mark.
You don't use a one, you use a token.
Yes, because it's usual way of specifying it. You use token when it is one instead of using number.
When I studied Petrinets, if we had a small number of tokens, we would draw all the tokens.
Yeah, like five tokens. They were drawn like circles inside it. So when we specify it from formal point of view, we introduce this notation. When you have multiplicity of firing condition, it is like marking and multiplicity of the arc connecting place with transition. So you have x divided by y if it is greater than 0. And you have infinity when you have an inhibitor arc and 0 marking. Otherwise, it is 0. And the transition fireable condition is computed as minimum on all its input places. So in the previous example, we had minimum equal to 2, so it was fired in 2 instances. And because of this small, at first glance, modification of the transition firing rule, we obtain such acceleration speed-up of computation for arithmetics. Clean, move, and copy, it is like auxiliary routines to compose program. We have constant complexity. For addition and substitution, we have constant complexity because it does not depend even on the data size. And for multiplication, we have logarithmic comparing to square. And finally, if we compute it on big numbers, we obtain exponential speed up using Slepcov nets. This example shows us peculiarity, how we express control flow. It is the way usual for Petri nets. We have a control flow which goes in sequence, firing transitions, and maybe some places can control some computations. This is like addition of amendments to have it to go in sequence, ordered sequence, to have no a few tokens in the same place. And the peculiarity of Slepcov net is using reverse control flow. Here we have moving token, and here we have moving zero. Zero marking is going through the net. We have initial unit. It is done because when you have zero marking, it does not restrict the number of instances of a transition.
Why did the direction switch?
Direction, you know, because zero is moving, so first marking moves here, zero moves here. Because to move zero, you should not move zero in a net. You can move only tokens. And this transition, when it fires, it moves one here and zero will be here. When the next fires, zeros moves here. So it looks like moving zero, but actually tokens are moving to the opposite direction. And because of it, the direction of arcs is reversed, because we have moving zero marking to control transition firing. And here we represent basic operations, because when we start programming, we think about standard operators. For instance, a sequence, when you write a sequence, maybe of some arithmetics. When you have branching if operator, it looks like these two branches and then they unite. Here you have a cyclic process which is repeated and it is exit from your cycle. And here is parallel execution. You have something like par begin, par end, when you have two branches which are developing in parallel, and then some join operation.
I'm sorry. I understood the functioning of moving the zeros instead of the ones, but I didn't get the advantage of that.
Oh, advantage consists in the transition firing rule. When you have not zero marking, but definite marking, it restricts the number of copies. The number of copies transition is fired in. When you have zero marking, you have infinity. So it does not restrict. If you attach this place with zero to some other transitions using inhibitor arcs, it will not restrict the number of copies of the transition. It is the basic reason why we use moving zero instead of moving unit, to not restrict the number of firing transitions. And here, after talking about basic operators, we come to this maybe basic operations. Some of them are auxiliary. We will study them afterwards. It is usual logic, not or and operations. It is usual arithmetics, addition, subtraction, comparison with zero. And finally, we come to the multiplication. It is a picture from IEEE paper. Fast multiplication for this Petri net, Slepcov net, excuse me. It was proven that it is exponentially faster to the usual multiplication Petri net. Yes, when...
Let me just finish my question. So my question is this. If most exascale complex dynamical systems with differential equations. How are you going to?
Yeah, at the end, at the end of my lecture, I have some, I think, half a dozen examples, including Laplace equation, fuzzy logic, cryptology, and some arithmetical computations. So I have applications of SlipSonNet for different areas. From maybe my point of view of, regarding exascale computing, recently exascale computing is very complicated and irregular. You should think about applying MPI, I mean standards, which are actual. You cannot write a parallel program in some language which goes and is executing on some a computer very fast. You should think about what kind of clusters, what kind of hardware will you use. You should think, will it be MPI approach and such like languages on the top level? When at the bottom you will think OMP, like you have parallel execution in the same memory, maybe some SIMD facilities. When you start thinking how to use GPU, and it is different kind, you can should send there somewhere, return, and it becomes very complicated and irregular area. And we offer a regular, simple approach, which can solve many problems of this irregularity. We have a language which preserves parallelism. You should not think how to make it in parallel on this, maybe abstract architecture on this. We have very fine granularity. You can start it and execute it. Yes, I agree, which it is something different than the mentioned three basic maybe techniques, like CUDA for GPU, OMP for maybe usual kind of multi-core architecture, and MPI when you have a few nodes of connection. But it is like homogeneous structure with fine granularity. There are advantage. I was going to talk later, but maybe it is useful to talk just now about advantages of this approach. And we can special kind of programming language, graphical programming language. We have operator and attached variables. We have this kind of dashed arcs, which are abbreviation of using this copying, cleaning and moving subnets for input and output variables. So when we draw these dashed arcs, it means we attach copying of variables which is put in separate places to some input places of an operator. So finally, after expansion of dashed dotted lines, arcs, we obtain big nets, and this plain inhibitor Slipsov nets is something like assembler language for modern processors. It is like assembler for processor of Slipsov net. So you have maybe high level net and this low level net, which is a machine language. But it is concurrent language. And here we have two ways of using hierarchy. We can have inline substitution of transition, like inline way of programming. Or we can have this call-return technique. Sometimes this is more interesting for parallel implementation because otherwise we should have reenterable nets to provide their independent concurrent executions. Like you have library procedure and you call it from different parts of your program in different threads. You should have reenterable ones. So sometimes it is better to have inline technique than call return technique. And it is paradigm of SlipSovNet computing. You have your program in loaded to high level net, you have input data as marking of its places. You have compiler which compiles your high level net into plain net, and it is executed on the processor of inhibitor of SlipSolve nets. And for getting utmost speed, I suggest to implement it as computing memory in hardware when we have a nanosecond, maybe less tact, and we have massively parallel structure, so it will give a breakthrough the performance when you will have SlipSolveNet software and implement it on SlipSolveNet hardware. And the central part of this paradigm is a processor or universal SlipSolveNet, which is executing a given SlipSolveNet as a program. So we come to it like people came years ago to universal Turing machine, which is like a prototype of modern computers. It is a prototype of SlipSolve net computer, and we developed a series of universal nets. When I was presenting the first one, which contained more than 1,000 nodes in Cottbus, Germany, someone asked me, how do you think the smallest net, what size will it have? And finally, we came to 39 for Universal SlipSolve Net, which published this year in like Computer Mathematics Journal. I will show reference later that it was published this year. And when we simulate universal nets by cellular automata, we can have even smaller, smallest possible blocks for simulating one cell consists of one place and two transitions. It was the best results achieved. And now maybe for more formal, like I was talking about complexity, I will trying to show more complex things. It is like design of the first universal Petri net, which was constructed. We have a code of a given Petri net as a marking of dedicated places. We have dynamics of Petri net specified by state equation. And finally, we have encoding. Vectors were encoded in a single integer numbers, like numbers in numbering system with radix R. Matrices were encoded like vectors by rows. And finally, we implemented it in recursive way using only multiplication and addition operation for encoding, and division and modular operations for decoding. So it is a design of this universal net. Here there is a number of places and transitions, code of matrix of input arcs, output arcs, code of marking, and two places to store trace. And it is topmost module or subnet of this universal net, and maybe some notation and usual C-like code. And its paths to check fireable transitions, to pick one fireable transition because we have non-deterministic way of firing transition. And the most complex module is firing because it goes two times for preserving restricted scale of marking. At first we compute using radix for utmost possible marking, greatest possible marking. Then after obtaining actual marking, we recalculate everything using actual smallest possible radix. Because of it, this subnet is most complex. So it is an example how we encode net for addition, maximal, and multiplication. It is rather big numbers, but this number corresponds to entire net after encoding. So we encode the entire given net as a single integer number, which is put in some place of universal net. And here are codes of markings and codes of traces when running these nets on universal net. And now I'd like to pay certain attention to design of smallest universal nets, because we'd like to have small nets when we come to practical implementation in hardware. We'd like to have smallest possible nets, and now they contain a few dozens of vertices. For constructing this net, we have chosen Neary and Woods small universal Turing machine with two states and four symbols, and then we provided some encoding of this machine, which uses rather sophisticated encoding of data, Turing machine, cyclic text system, cellular automata, and then input of this universal machine. And we have even more long chain, because we have deterministic inhibitor PetriNet, which is encoded in by text system, and then we repeat the same chain of encoding. It is the transition table of the Neary and Woods small universal Turing machine. Here is encoding of the Turing machine tape. We have three numbers. Left part of the tape, current symbol in a single place, and the right part of the tape in one place. After this encoding, we encode blank symbols. Weekly universal Turing machine has blank symbols instead of empty symbol to the left and to the right on its tape. And it is design of this universal net. It uses three subnets. It is transition function, multiplication, addition, and modular division, because it is like encoding and decoding to simulate moves of the head of this Turing machine. We simulate each instruction of Turing machine. In this way, we have a single transition, and input arcs represent the multiplicity, the code of the current symbol and the code of the current state, and produce next state and next symbol, and move either to the left or to the right on the tape. It is a model of the transition table of the Turing machine, and it is subnet which implements multiplication addition by five, because we have only four symbols. We use this radix 5, maximal number plus 1, and we have 0 for nothing, for absence of encoding. So, yeah, maybe it is good time, but we will postpone it. And in the same way, we implement division. We take 5 token and put 1. In this way, we implement division, because we take 5 and put 1, it is division by 5, and it is final design of this universal net, and it is table of simulating it, which was done on computer and completely corresponds to the original paper of Neary and Woods. The smallest possible universal nets we obtained by simulating cellular automata number 110. It is very interesting kind of model for computation, the most simple in my opinion. Its universality has been proven by Matthew Cook, and we constructed minimized variant of transition firing rules using this Carnot card to have these rules of cellular automaton minimized. Because of it, we have the smallest possible net I was talking about with two transitions in one place to have it for one cell. And it is parametric specification of this net. And when we switch to using usual Petri nets, we were doing it in traversals of the sequence of models. We constructed some intermediate nets to calculate state difference and to change the cell state. And finally, we implemented this strategy, which I named like boomerang and barrier, because you have to widen the stretch of cells you are using for simulation. It looks like you throw a boomerang. It makes this barrier like put down it, and next time you will throw wider stretch, and the same in the opposite direction, so it is like widening stretch of the tape, and it is the net which represents this strategy of switching. We have a transition which fires once, like breaking this barrier, and the strip of tape is widening. It is parametric specification. We use this special language when we deal with infinite Petri nets. Tomorrow I will have a lecture in New Jersey Institute of Technology. It will be completely devoted to this kind of notation and infinite Petri nets. But it is simulation of ether, which you will find many examples in the book of Stephen Wolfram, The New Kind of Science, devoted completely to cellular automata, and in papers of Matthew Cook, who has proven universality. So we simulated ether using different patterns of Petri net marking, and we've proven that we can simulate it with this strategy. But I'd like to mention that the smallest possible nets have been obtained when we directly simulated Turing machine, which simulates cellular automaton, a Turing machine of Neary and Woods. They are very clever couple of people from Ireland, and they made everything small and fast, which goes regarding to universal computations, universal Turing machines, and other models. Before them, fastest universal nets belonged to Watanabe, weakly universal models, and they made everything even smaller and faster. So it is the smallest cell to simulate one cell of Turing machine tape. And using this kind of cell, we have this model and this parametric specification of it. So I'd rather say a series of universal Petri and Slipsov nets have been constructed. It is the smallest net published this year. It's overall design, encoding of transition function. And here we merged two subnet for modular division and multiplication and addition. Because of it was possible to reduce the number of places and transitions. And it is the final design of this universal net. And now we'll come to the maybe more practical stuff, which concerns application of Slipsov net for programming. Here I have a sequence of examples which show how we can implement them to write program for different areas of application. Here we have RSA encoding decoding procedure, which use like this power and modular operations for encoding and decoding. And it is LipsomNet, which can do it very fast. It uses subnets for reversing notation of your code. For multiplication, division by two, it is optimized division by constant. And usual multiplication and usual division. So we can use this LipsomNet. If had it been implemented in hardware, we have very fast system for RCA encoding and decoding. It may be interesting not only for people like positive for breaking RSA codes, it could be interesting as well. And now you know RSA is implemented not at the topmost level. Usually people have like MD5 and such like technique for data communication, and they exchange MD5 keys using RSA because RSA is not so fast as other techniques for encoding and decoding. And using speed up of computation on LipsomNet and using hardware of for LipsomNet, we can move it on the lower level and have RCA encoding decoding implemented in hardware. We can use this technique, more maybe reliable technique for data exchange in routine procedures using this kind of implementation. It is maybe example which people think not often about, because usually it is like parallel, concurrent, but not solving equation. It is a net which solves Laplace equation on a plane. We can solve it in three-dimensional space, in d-dimensional space.
Is this supposed to be an internal representation of the net, or you're not going to program this by compiling?
It is program. It is program.
But you
know,
you would rather just write that equation.
I've written this equation, and I've written this like different scheme. Different scheme, usual different scheme, you have it like sum from neighbors. I've chosen it because it is rather simple. Because, you know...
So I'm just asking if this is going to be an internal representation and the user is going to type in the difference equation.
You know...
I'm not going to type in
that net. Maybe users can type it in some higher level language.
Right.
Using like one central, for instance, one central, and to show neighbors how it comes from neighbors and how it is recomputed. But
you
it is
need to draw the net for one cell, because then it's they are connected.
Yeah, it is connected, and we have like boundary conditions, which are expressed using this for left bound multiplicity of arcs, upper boundary condition, and so on, like right and bottom boundary condition. You recalculate, and then this 4 means division by 4. Because when you recomputed it, you send it here, here, and to the neighbor. From here you send to 4 neighbors,
so
1, 2, 3, 4. So the scheme is one transition. One transition is a scheme which is repeated. It is a pattern. But you know, if you have implementation in hardware, it will recompute it on the entire net, which is obtained dividing entire lattice, maybe. Yes, lattice is more correct word here. In a single tact, it will recompute it on the entire lattice. If you create...
I'm still asking you a different question. I mean, here you have a 4x4.
Yes.
You know, in a real simulation, I might have a 1,000x1,000 or 100,000x100,000.
Yes.
So it's not... You're obviously not going to draw that.
You know, if you try to implement Slepcov net in hardware, it will be something like PLM. You know, years ago it was like all the rage with PLM. They are very fast, but now people prefer for many application programmable controllers before PLM. From my point of view, it is not motivated sometimes. It is not just because PLM run very fast. Because if you optimized everything for PLM, it will be different scale. And PLM provide rather big size of this lattice. You can have not 4x4, but 1,000x1,000 using PLM and good enough density of transistors on the crystal. So you can have 1,000x1,000, and if you have greater scale, you can provide usual scaling, moving it to the chip and moving somewhere. But if it is, it will be the same like memory, computing memory will be the same in its cost like memory, you will have very huge nets which will be sitting in this computing memory, and to make computation it will be the same like to store data. The same expenses will be to make very simple operation: division, multiplication, addition.
I'm just trying to understand.
Only
let me finish my sentence. You have to let me finish my sentence.
Oh, excuse me.
Yeah. I just want to ask you a question, that's all. My question again is, you're not going to program at this level. Do you agree?
Sometimes, you know, people write programs in C language. Sometimes they write programs in C++. And even now, I've found people who write their programs in assembler language. So different maybe significance of efficiency for different application will require different languages for Slepcov net approach as well. Sometimes you will be using high level language of schemata using subnets, which will be substituted, tied together these dashed lines for drawing programs. And then when it comes to the level of implementation on a definite Slepcov net processor, it will be this level. So here, if we compare with the previous slide, it is like a higher level language, because these are subnets: multiplication, division, and so on. Here we have this net on the lower level. And it is simple enough, because usually when you try to understand an assembler program, and you have no explanations, it's like a puzzle.
I think for me the best analogy would be to see, engineers use Simulink a lot. Do you know Simulink? It's a data flow language.
Data flow? Yeah, because
Simulink is a data flow language.
Yes, and here it is namely data flow approach you were asking about, because
My thought is this. They have very complicated models, they're graphical models, so I guess it's analogous to this.
But, you know, they have, like in UML, they have models which, in my opinion, are sometimes irregular, because An advantage of SleepSolveNet is the possibility of proving correctness of concurrent programs, which still is present here, because...
I haven't heard you talk about proving these things.
Yeah, because I have the list of advantages, and it was like beside the set of slides for this talk, but we have a sequence of results which are applicable and were applied for proving correctness of parallel programs which are modeled using SleepSolveNet PetriNet language. And it is an advantage of using this model for modern driven development, because you have a language for which it is possible to prove correctness of parallel program from formal point of view. These possibilities adds on to the list of advantages of this approach, the possibility of proving. Because many graphical languages, I should mention Dataflow as well, excuse me, I will make another version of slides to cover. This area is well, very interesting approach, because control data flow, different ways of control. And here we have possibility to use both ways. In the previous example, it was control flow. Here it is data flow. So it is another approach. It is one more example when we have a fuzzy logic function and we have SleepSolveNet, which implements directly this fuzzy logic function. It is not like usual function. We have for fuzzy logic, we have for conjunction like minimum operation. For disjunction, we have maximum operation. A variable takes value from 0 to 1, any value, and this... negation is symmetry with regard to diagonal. Now, many controllers use fuzzy logic for their implementations, and we can do it using SleepSolveNet as well, because their transition firing rules employ this minimum operation. So, fuzzy logic is implemented here. And one more example from the area of control, linear control. For instance, in linear control, people usually have this kind of equation, x for input, y for output, and a few matrices. Here, for simplicity, this transformation using matrix D was omitted, having D equal to 0. And we constructed also net, which is using, pay special attention, it is also using data flow approach. It recomputes everything and uses two tags to recompute it for all variables in the system. So very fast linear control is implemented using SleepSolveNet. And I think for this bunch of slides, it is like the lot with applications. I will give a brief overview. Encryption, decryption, security. Laplace equation, mathematical physics, differential equations, fuzzy logic, and other types of logic are implemented here, and linear control, very fast linear control. So when we come to the advantages of SleepSolveNet, we come to this advantage. When PetriNets run exponentially slow, PetriNets are slow for arithmetic, SleepSolveNets run fast. That is why, in my opinion, when I was talking with people in the United States, experienced some euphoria in 70s with regard to PetriNets, like a model of parallel concurrent computations. And many, many bright people I can mention, like Malloy, Hack, which results were great, James Peterson as well. And then there was a kind of pessimism with regard to PetriNets, because from practical point of view, their slowness, in my opinion, was the basic point why they were not applied for having real-life language for concurrent computations. And now SlipsovNet mends this flaw. We have very fast and concurrent model which can be implemented like a real-life language for concurrent programming. Universal PetriNet is a prototype of processor in this paradigm, and we constructed a series of universal nets, smallest contains some 39 nodes. And besides, SlipsovNet computing offers graphical concurrent language, formal verification of concurrent programs' correctness, fine granulation of parallel processes, and massively parallel computations. I'd rather say graphical concurrent language which preserves natural parallelism of application area. Because when people were programming for years, they were thinking about the application areas like concurrent parallel processes, but they were obliged to express it in sequence in usual languages. Now, recently, they started using a few threads to express parallelism, but they try to squeeze in this restricted number of 4 threads for 4 cores, maybe now 8 threads for 8 cores, to squeeze in everything and make it in optimal way. Why they should not think about maximal possible parallelism, which your application area reveals you? When you start programming, from the very beginning, you think about some restriction. When you think about preserving it, and when you will have these massively parallel facilities, it will be the best way to achieve the best speed with fine granulation of computations. As for formal verification, when you have this model in model-driven approach, and each step from the very beginning having draft model, you can prove correctness. And for intermediate model, maybe it will be difficult from computational point of view for some real-life application, but when it is control of some space shuttle, it is possible to have computing resources of supercomputer to prove formally correctness of this program, which is significant. When you start thinking about programs, we only believe in correctness of Windows, of other programs. Only believe, because they were tested on some definite number of tests. And beyond this test, we should believe that they are correct. We should prove correctness of programs for very significant applications. And when it is concurrent program, it's even more difficult to prove. Here we have these brilliant facilities to prove correctness. And finally, I'd like to mention basic references. This International Journal of Computer Mathematics, where the smallest universal net was published. Some results, they published it in the list of papers. Now you will find the 18th year. Now is 2017, but it is published, but the number of journal on the list 18th year, I don't know why. And we published a lot of papers which were starting from the universal first universal PetriNet, and then implementing some other models of computations of PetriNet. Recently, I published a paper together. We published together with Ji Wu Li from Republic China Public Republic, devoted to simulating Turing machine using PetriNets, any Turing machine, not definite like in this speech, but any given Turing machine. So all the papers are put in the same bench with slides. I will deliver them freely. Please read them, cite them. And maybe I'd like to ask you, these hashtags were introduced on Facebook and on Twitter. On Twitter, maybe only in English language, it is written in Russian language. Please support these hashtags, which are devoted to SlipsolveNet and SlipsolveNet computing, because it was made in Ukraine, and you know, I'm in colors of my flag, but on the t-shirt is written USA. It is friendship between our countries. So please support Ukraine, Ukrainian scientists, because we are entering this high-level society of world science. Thank you very much for your attention. And maybe your questions.
Soviet Union, Anatoly Ilyich Slipsov in Donetsk, in plant Topaz, which was producing radio spy stations, known and used, had a special shop in this plant with this kind of net implemented in hardware. A specialized hardware, but it was not completely in hardware, it was running some microprogram simulator on some small computer. And there was experimental line which moved the arm of a robot to take some raw material, put on the rotating table, and maybe swap with rotation and return back. So there was an experimental line where this kind of net were controlling some robotic line of manufacture. But it was years ago, and there were no financial support in this direction, no developments in this area. It is one example which I was watching when I came to Anatoly Ilyich as PhD student. One example. I heard during some speech of representatives in Germany, some company, I try to remember, it is named Klaschka. Klaschka, maybe not widely known, they provide controllers for attaching real-life devices, and they had some event processor implemented, having implementing PetriNet models for this event processor. There are a few software simulators for PetriNet, but Klaschka maybe true hardware implementation. It was one example I heard about. So
maybe FPGAs.
What?
FPGAs and sort of programmable hardware. On those you can run.
And where they were developed?
There are several companies that developed those. One of the most famous brands is called Xilinx. I'm not an expert.
Well, you can just get everything he's talking about from the Amazon cloud, and you can just put it on the cloud. Mm.
Now, the development of hardware is like more regular. You have this VLC systems, you can develop it at home.
Mm-hmm.
And then maybe you should have support to order it be implemented and cheap. But you can simulate everything, and maybe for our goal at this stage to find a project to get it implemented in software and prepare everything for hardware implementation and prove achievements on real life tests like GreenPack, LabPack, to run them on simulators of SlipSolveNet, and it will be more vivid proof for companies to involve them, to get them involved in this proof.
I just had another very basic question I just didn't understand in the beginning of your talk. I mean, you said at the end that these nets are basically exponentially faster. Can I call you back in a minute? Okay, yeah, you're good. Okay, I'll call you back. So you had mentioned that this exponential difference in speeds. So that must mean that somehow Petri nets are doing some sort of interleaved concurrency, and you're doing, these guys are doing true concurrency or something.
No, it is mostly explained because of incremental way of computations in PetriNet. So when you do some arithmetic in PetriNet, you should only, when you have like ordinary PetriNet, you either subtract unit, like decrement, or add unit, increment.
So, if the Petri nets to be exponential, I mean, the Petri nets are inefficient in computing arithmetic.
Yes,
okay.
They are inefficient. And in my opinion, because they are inefficient, they do it slowly, it was the reason people became pessimistic with place transition net, because there were no possibility to have a homogeneous concept to implement everything required for a programming language.
Mm-hmm. What was the
story? In PetriNets, if you have to implement, say, a subtraction, you have to run as one transition for each unit.
One transition means plus one minus one, so incremental character of computation.
Okay,
all right. Sort of,
now
yes.
Okay.
Merge the transitions.
Thank you. It's a very, very interesting.
Very interesting talk.
Very nice.
Thank you for your attention. And I don't know in what way it is better to deliver my slides. I can send maybe everything in an archive to Scott. And as for papers, I can give you personally, but usually I do not put them on the side, some internet site, because of journals have certain restrictions. But if you are got interested, I can deliver my personal copies. Thank you very much.
Thank you again.
Thank you.